Well, hello everyone. I'm Gary Hamill. I'm here with my colleague Michele Zanini, and welcome to the New Human Movement. Today we're going to have a conversation with one of the most extraordinary leaders that Michele and I have had the pleasure of knowing and working with, Angela Ahrendts. Angela was most recently the senior vice president at Apple, where she led their sprawling retail business. During her 5 years at Apple, she was instrumental in integrating their offline and online retail businesses. That's a business that sees a billion visitors a year. She played a big role in redesigning their stores, in reimagining the customer experience in quite profound ways, and in recrafting the roles of more than 70,000 associates. Prior to her stint at Apple, Angela led Burberry, the iconic British fashion brand, for near a decade, turning that around, revitalizing it, setting it on a new path, and creating extraordinary value for all of their shareholders and stakeholders. Angela sits on several boards, including Ralph Lauren and Airbnb, and recently took on the role of being the chair for Save the Children International. So, Angela, thanks for taking a little time to talk to us.
It's always an honor, Gary.
Well, I want to dig in. You know, the conversation we want to have with you is really around, what does it take to be a human-centered leader? And in a way, it sounds kind of dumb to even, like, because, like, what else are you leading if it's not human beings? So, and yet, just a couple of data points that we might have shared with some of our viewers in the past, but kind of for your benefit. You know, Jim Clifton, who runs Gallup, which probably knows more about the state of the workplace around the world than anybody else, Jim has said that, you know, most CEOs, I'm gonna quote him, don't care about their employees. He didn't qualify. He just said they don't care about their employees. And maybe he's right, maybe he's wrong, but I'll leave it to some others perhaps to challenge them. And if you look at the data around the world that they collect and others collect, it's not a very reassuring picture. For example, a recent large study in Europe by Eurofound, they discovered that only a quarter of managers across Europe believe their employees have a role to play in creating competitive advantage. So despite all the talk about people being important, their most valuable resource, that's not the way people feel. It's not what the data shows. So maybe, Angela, start to reflect, if you will, on you know, how you brought that human spirit, how that showed up in your work at Burberry, perhaps before, in your work at Apple. What for you does it take to be somebody who really encourages people, inspires them, and inspires them to do their best?
Yeah, Gary, I think that it's I always find it fascinating, you know, talking to you, and like, but I also find it fascinating that so many leaders in large companies don't, their company is the world that they live in, but their employees live in the real world. And the real world has changed dramatically the last 10 years with, you know, the onset of the phone and social media, et cetera. So in their own world, they have a voice and they're allowed to be heard and they have an opinion and people like it or don't like it and it starts dialogue. But then they go into an office environment and they don't have a voice. Nobody's asking, nobody's listening. If they do respond, they're locked into this little department, if you will, right? With that boss and that boss and that boss. And as you say, everything else that is, but their voice isn't, but they're exposed over here. What they're reading, what they're seeing, where they're traveling, they can contribute on such a scale. And I think it's one of the reasons that you have more people leaving the workforce today, and you have a huge wave of entrepreneurialism that's starting to happen, because with technology and with all of their knowledge, they can actually do things on their own. So I just think that companies, most institutions, be it education or otherwise, have not kept pace with how dynamically different humans in an organization want to behave. So I think those leaders that do, are the ones that have pivoted. You know, it used to be, you know, I don't know if it's Cotter or who it was, but, you know, people, product, processes, right? And that was always but the leaders that really know, they brought purpose into that. They brought planet into that, because they, again, know that all of their employees, those are the things they care about. And so those that are listening have evolved the narrative. You know, they're not ticking a box on ESG. They're because that's all things they're talking about outside of their company. That they 68% of Gen Z says they would change brands for those that care about the environment.
Can I interrupt there for a minute, Angela? Because what I hear you saying is that there's a new generation coming to work that has been deeply shaped by social media, deeply resonant with some of the challenges in the world, and that their expectations have been changing faster than the reality of the workplace. Is that, maybe you could expand on that a bit.
Yeah, faster than the evolution of leadership, let's say, right? Because leaders change that workplace. And so what I used to always say at Apple, at all of our big offsites where we get 1,500, 2,000 people together, I would stand on stage, and this was the leadership managing 70,000 people around the world in 40 countries. And I would challenge them, and I would say, whether you like it or not, Instagram, YouTube, WeWork world, like that's the world they live in. So are you communicating more with, you know, rather than just sitting in a meeting, are you communicating more with images? Are you reacting? Are you getting out and touching people and watching people and listening to people? You know, are you doing more in the terms of videos? I mean, I would do a video every single week to 70,000 employees, not just to the leadership team, to 70,000 employees, because we weren't relying on it to go from here to here to here to here to here to here, or sending an email that you've got to translate into 30 some odd languages and hoping that they'll read. You know, it's a YouTube world. Are you evolving your leadership style and getting your key messages? We would do three thoughts in 3 minutes or less. And the added benefit, Gary, that people don't realize is the engagement scores doubled, because they would rather sit there and watch a 3 minute video than read a 10 page email that you're going to send them. Again, that's their norm. And so if that's their norm, it's hard to bring that inside.
Yes, it's hard to get it's hard to get your heart to show up in an email, right? It's a very impersonal kind of a form of communication. But Angela, let me follow up on that a minute. You know, I think a lot of leaders are very used to having very scripted communication, right? And in a big company, you have a comms team and people are second guessing every word and trying to project. Like you were using the tools that your young workforce was using to be in touch and communicate with them. But how do you make sure that message has authenticity? How do you make sure that it has heart and doesn't come across as just more like slickly packaged corporate, you know, communications? How do you be vulnerable in that setting, I guess I'd ask?
Yeah, Gary, I think vulnerable is the perfect word. They can see, because they're watching so much, because so much on Netflix and so much on YouTube, and, you know, they can tell a fake image on Instagram faster than you and I could ever. And that's their world. That's their senses. They're so sharp and they're trained that way. So you get up and you try and read something, I mean, you will have zero engagement. It's not just doing a video to do a video. And my thing is, I come from the school of servant leadership. So, you know, you have to serve and you have to be there and you have to be humble and you have to connect if you care, if you're doing a video because you think then don't do it. But if you are doing a video so they can feel you, see you, you know, hear you, and build a deeper connection to have a more trusting bond with you. Because the minute that you can get trust, and you can build trust in a video, I've done it my whole life, you build that foundation of trust, that's empowering. And then they want more, and then they feel free, and then they'll start thinking creatively, and they'll naturally collaborate and feedback because they feel you trust them. And then what's interesting is you exhibit that behavior, that authentic, you know, it goes back to the old Maya Angelou quote, right? They'll forget what you said, they'll forget what you did, but they'll never forget the way you made them feel. And I think that so many leaders today, they don't want to be vulnerable, Gary. And it's not about serving the constituency. It's about getting a message out or, you know, telling people to do something. where I believe, you know, we said at Apple early on, we're going to flip it upside down. And there was this incredible little company and this very vibrant team of people who came in. And I think we did the largest crowdsourcing exercise that had ever been done in multiple languages. And for 6 months, we asked them to feedback. What do you feel Apple should be doing more of in your community? And that alone, we were asking, and we were creating forums, and they were feeding back. And our retention scores went from mid-50s over the course of 5 years up to 91%.
Which, by the way, is crazy. That's crazy high in retail, right? That's unprecedented in retail, basically.
It's polar opposite of an average retailer. I mean, an average retailer retains 20% of their workforce. So Apple was already high. But and so that was one of the things. We did a lot of other things to make sure that they heard us. But it starts with consistent, honest, authentic communication. And if they don't feel you and they don't believe you and they don't trust you, then they're not all in. But if they trust you and you do what you say you're going to do, and not just once. I mean, I did videos every week for 5 years, Gary, no matter where I was in the world, no matter what time it was. And, you know, and then we did a lot of other things for them as well that, you know, that equalized, that made them understand we deeply cared about them as an individual, and not just about them, but we wanted their minds. We wanted them to help us move faster and make a bigger impact. And
so, Angela, you were referring there a minute ago to the internal crowdsourcing platform Apple uses, Loop, and how, I guess, for the first time, you know, 70,000 employees had a way of sharing their ideas, which I think was obviously very powerful for them. But let me come back to this issue you raised about trust for a moment, and then if maybe you want to say a bit more on the crowdsourcing, we'll go somewhere else. But come back to trust. You know, it seems to us, McKinley and I have argued that, you know, one of the deepest assumptions we have in organizations is that people work for the organization. And that's true. I mean, they get a paycheck. But in that way of thinking, that human being is just like a factor of production. They're an instrument, right? They're being used as an instrument to serve a customer, to produce profits, whatever. And our contention is that you kind of have to turn that around, that while that's technically true, the way you have to think is, no, people are free agents, and they choose to work with us, and they choose to work with us because our company is a way they can better their lives. They can gain new skills, they can earn an income, they can make a difference in their community, but where it's the institution that's the instrument, not the human being. So how, and I sense that coming through in the way you're talking, what were the things beyond this frequent, relentless putting yourself out on the line, having this as much as you could, a one-to-one conversation with these people? How did you communicate, or what did you do, or what did Apple do to let employees know we are investing in you, right? We want you to have a path forward in Apple beyond, but how did you flip that from like fact or production to no, this is a place where you can personally succeed?
Yeah, and do realize that, you know, Apple's probably the most desired company to want to work for, right? So you had that. Retail was not always the intuitive way in, if you will. Right? I always said everyone wants to go to Oz, everyone wants to go to Cupertino. And especially in China, in a lot of the, you know, highly educated markets, et cetera. So we changed the narrative completely. And what we started doing very early on was making sure that everything in those retail stores throughout the world was exactly the same as it was in Cupertino. So one of the first year there, I noticed that really no one except for the retail executives in Cupertino got shares in the company. And I went to Tim and shared examples of some of the top companies in America, and, you know, from Starbucks to United, et cetera, who gave their employees free shares. And I think that Apple is the number one employee. It is an incredible company. So I was just highlighting with him that, you know, I think it would be great. It would be a wonderful retention thing. And I'm telling you, within 3 months, him and the CFO put a program together. And to this day, every retail employee, part-time and full-time, are still getting free shares in the company. You know, how can Tim talk about the company and not treat everybody equal? And then the following year, everyone in Cupertino, those who make the most get a $5,200 education allowance every year. But those who might need it the most didn't have one. So year two, we gave everyone an education allowance. Year three, we equalized the benefits. Year four, so each year, Gary, we were announcing one significant thing that said, we love you, we value you, you are instrumental. And I think one of the really important things is, I would always say, welcome to Apple, when someone would join the retail organization, because it was their foot in the door. And then we also worked on programs with all of the executives in the center, and we would actually promote 400 to 500 retail employees into Cupertino every year. So took time to get it going, but they also knew that. So there were these programs, these internships they could come and do, and there was a high probability they could get hired. We were our own internal recruiting organization, if you will. And we ended up laying off hundreds of recruiters because people were coming into retail, they were staying. Those who were on the fast track and wanted to move, they now had an opportunity into the center. So you weren't stuck. You came into this big, monolithic, incredible company, and you had a choice, and it was your choice. Nobody, and let's face it, you don't want 80% of the retail teams to want to move to Cupertino, right? Everybody's at a different life phase. And so if you want that choice, wonderful. If you want to be in Apple retail, wonderful. Stay there, serve our customers, but you still should be given the same benefits of everyone in the company. And I will tell you, Tim and Luca, and it was unbelievable that the team that enabled all of that to happen. And you can imagine the cost, but you can also imagine the benefit because of those retention rates. And then they served customers better. They were more knowledgeable. They were happier.
What you're describing here is very interesting because, you know, obviously, you know, there are many things in companies where you have multiple layers. There are many things that can make people on the front lines feel like second or third class citizens, right? And we've sometimes argued that if you're not careful, that formal hierarchy ends up kind of being like a caste system. And clearly you're going to have pay differentials based on responsibility and experience. But what if I hear you right, what you're saying is you were working year after year to kind of reduce that social distance, right? Reduce that kind of the perceived, if you like it, the hierarchical privilege and ensure that to the extent possible, everyone had the same deal. Everyone had a path forward. And I think, you know, there's a huge lesson in that of just being relentless about looking at those places where the people on the front lines feel like we're not really part of this. This doesn't feel like ours. We don't have the same opportunities. And just relentlessly, you know, trying to change that. That's, I think, a deep lesson there. But Michele, jump in here.
So, Angela, I wanted to pick up on the point you were making. You described yourself as a disciple of, you know, Robert Greenleaf and servant leadership, right? And that whole way of looking at the role of a leader in an organization. And I think your examples you provided from, you know, the work where you engage people around, you know, what impact might we make in our communities, you know, across Apple retail, and then the efforts to bring those benefits that were available to non-retail employees, to retail employees, are very good examples of that, right? Because if I remember correctly, I think there are four components of servant leadership. The first is service to others, right? The servant as a leader and not leader as a servant, right? So that's, you're motivated by the fact that you're exercising power to benefit others, right? The second is that you have a very holistic approach to work. That is, you the work exists for the person as much as the person exists for the work, right? So it's not, as Gary said, it's not you serve the institution is helping you. Promoting a sense of community, creating those connections across everyone. And I think the last point is around sharing power and decision-making. That is, you know, not telling people here's our community strategy, but rather asking them where can we have an impact in our communities. So that's all incredibly powerful and very inspiring. I guess my question to you is, as you look at the work, your career so far and the interactions you've had with other people who are in positions of authority, how many do you think you think kind of adhere to those kinds of principles of servant leadership? Is it 50%? Is it 5%? Is it somewhere in the middle? Is it more? Like, are you like the exemplar of a small minority, or do you think this is kind of a common set of attitudes and inclinations?
Yeah, it's a really great question. It's a provocative question. it's interesting. I look at, and so I don't know the exact percentage. I would hope that at least 25-30% would be this way. I look at David Taylor at P&G. I look at Doug McMillon at Walmart. I look at, I look at Tim Cook today, and Tim's doing videos now every month and doing, taking that on. And so I don't have an exact number, but I think there are absolutely a handful running very large companies that absolutely get it, understand it, et cetera. The tough part is probably the older, more traditional sectors, industries, probably are more challenged. They've been more hierarchical by nature. And I'm hesitant to name sectors, but I think retail and tech are both slightly different. I think consumer packaged goods is probably right there. Then if you jump over to law or finance or, it's very different, I think. And my daughter has some friends that graduated college, et cetera. And you hear what these kids are being put through their first year at some of these institutions. And it's like, wow, the fact that the kids will even still go through it, in order to, and it's crazy. It's crazy, but I don't know.
It's a minority though. Yeah, right. It's fair to say that it's a minority.
Yeah,
I don't want to put words in your mouth, but
yeah, I don't. I mean, again, you meet a lot more people than I do, but it takes a selfless leader. I never handed out a business card at Burberry. And I don't think I even did at Apple. I leave them in the drawer. Because the minute you got on a plane and somebody asked you what you did, and you might be having a nice conversation, and the minute they knew who you were, the whole conversation changed.
Right.
And I don't care about titles. I don't care about, but I think that people have worked so hard to get somewhere, that they're going to hold on to that now at any cost. And it's not about power. It's not, when I hear people talk about power, I said on a call the other day, I have never used the word power in my 43-year career, ever. I don't even know what that means.
Right.
Influence, inspiration, but power?
Yeah. Can I ask you another question though, related to this? So short of cloning you, which, maybe we'll be able to do once the technology catches up, short of cloning you, is what can we do to get other, people in positions of authority to have this kind of predisposition, this kind of worldview, right? Especially if they've been at playing this game for some time, and it might be hard for them to make a transition. But I heard you speak on this topic previously and write about it as well. And you I think you're confident that we can actually help people make this kind of transition. That it's, we just can't give up, right, on the people. And so, can you maybe say a little bit more about that? Like, what would you do to help, maybe take that number, which is, maybe not super low, but maybe also not super high, and get it to be the vast majority of people in positions of authority to be more like, servant leaders?
Yeah. One of the things I think is, and you guys have all of these facts, the number of companies that have outperformed, that have this approach and have the people first approach, and have it very purpose-driven and purpose-led, you know, with deep values throughout the culture. So I don't think, you know, a lot of executives, when they reach that level, they're very left-brain and very fact-based. And there is rich data on this fact that these are the types of companies that outperform. I mean, you know, it's actually interesting. Nobody could compete with Amazon until Doug got in position at Walmart. And the way that Doug leads that company, they are in, I mean, it's in, I love the race now. But I argue he does that because of who he is and his value. And they know he cares and he's authentic. So anybody can do it. Now, we also may not have a lot of the right leaders in the right place if they are so ego-driven and honestly don't understand and don't, then you know, I not necessarily a stock I'd invest in, but I do think, funny, I was at an offsite last weekend, and I also think that until we create another metric, so it's not just a P&L, and we proposed at this offsite last week, call it a P&I, right? A people and an impact. And what is as important as revenue over here? And what is important as gross profit, you know, over here? And how do you measure culture? And how do you, and then you have to report on both of them, not just the hard revenue profit. And then that's where everybody focuses. That's the bonus they get paid. And then it gets really hard to separate a lot of people when you're making a lot of money to come back in and say, no, wait a minute, it would be better if you did it this way. And so I think until there's a balanced scorecard that they have to report on, then I don't know how, I think it might be hard to change a lot of the stalwarts in the older traditional industries.
I hope you're enjoying the conversation. I wanted to take just a quick moment to thank Hire for supporting the work of the new human movement. Hire is the world's leading appliance maker with subsidiaries around the world. Over the last decade, it's been leading a revolution in management. At Hire, every employee reports to customers, not to managers. And the company has worked hard to make entrepreneurship everyone's job. Now, back to our conversation.
Yeah, that's certainly been our sense, that until we're keeping score of these things in a new way. And, you know, I mean, and this has a long history, right? Before we really started keeping track of safety in cars, it wasn't a priority. And Ralph Nader and others said we have to pay attention until we started taking medical errors seriously. You know, the whole healthcare industry was not that focused on improving quality and environment in the same. So if, let's stick with that for a moment, Angela, because I know this has been an interest and a passion of yours. If a company wanted to say, what do we need to be looking at to start to really measure our human impact and whether we're using these human beings in the best possible way, what kind of things should they be looking at? What would be on that scorecard that you'd want to see?
I would want them to prove they're a flat organization. I would want them to prove that everyone has a say on everyone. So call it almost 360 approaches or 360 ways to communicate on every single person in the company. And what was that person's score? What was that department score? What was the company score? You know, by office, around the world, et cetera. And then that gets put back. That's a culture score then, right? This is, and so whatever those four or five things you come up with. But if I were an investor, I would want to know how connected that culture is and how happy that culture is and how, you know, united they were behind the strategy or the vision. And if that culture score were really high, I'd absolutely invest in that company. But if that culture score was really low, that gave me insight. Then I would ask more questions about how they were achieving those numbers. But I think without this other side, you're just simply getting, you know, and we all know how numbers can be, you know, manipulated on the edges, et cetera. But I think you need the balance. And I think culture is one. I think that, you know, is everyone aligned around the purpose and the values? How do you measure that? You know, does everyone support, you know, what the company is lean, and every company can't lean into everything. But, you know, there is, you know, with the new ESG measures, like you said, there we're going to measure the environmental piece. You know, governance, we've measured for a long time. There's enough things in there. But then there's the social piece in the center that nobody's talking a lot about. And the social goes inside of the company, but it also goes outside the company. And, you know, at Apple, we didn't just say we were going to turn ourselves upside down. We said we're going to turn ourselves inside out because the community had needs and we could help meet those needs. And we did start to measure whether or not we were doing that. Apple could absolutely start putting up their social impact.
Yeah, I think that was a very interesting thing at Apple Retail. I mean, many companies, you know, they'll have environmental outreach programs and people give a certain amount of their time and they can volunteer and they're supporting charities. But you literally asked tens of thousands of people around the world, how can we make a difference in your community? What was surprising when you asked that question? Because I don't know of any company that's really asked people on the front lines in the communities, what do you need from us?
Well, and our whole purpose for doing that was, you know, I mean, 500 million people a year would walk into those 500 Apple stores. So you can do the math. And so what I said was, you were actually a hub for your community, for all generations, for all nationalities. You were single-handedly more people walked into that Apple store than went to church or went to anywhere else. And so therefore, maybe you had a higher purpose. And then we would also say that we wanted the teams to be hired to reflect that community. And if you had a huge Mandarin population, then, you know, if that was 15% of the population, then make sure 15% of your staff speaks Mandarin. You know, when we opened up Queens outside of New York City, the staff spoke 28 different languages because you have to serve your community. So it, you know, that's pretty much 101. But again, I wonder how many companies do that. Apple didn't do it 5-6 years ago. We were using auto translate on iPads. So we said, if the community is coming into you, you must welcome them. You must reflect the community. And then when we created the whole Today at Apple experience, you know, and this wasn't my genius, this was Steve Jobs' genius, because he told the team from day one, your job is to enrich their lives. Do it through the lens of education. Tell them something they don't know that this can do to enrich their lives. And that's why to this day, there's no commission in an Apple store. They're not incentivized on any of that. That was his genius. And so all we did was try and make that come alive and take everything that you could do on that device and put it together as educational experiences, not just for individuals, for all of the entrepreneurs that are getting, and you know, we started putting boardrooms in the store so all the entrepreneurs could come in and meet each other and talk to each other and, you know, figure things out together. And there was an Apple Business Pro that was there to help them. And so, you know, the community has families. They started to ask about families. Why give Apple back that old phone or that old device? Drop it down in the family. We'll show you how to do that. So I think when you have a human lens on it, Gary, inside of the company, but then you understand you have a greater responsibility for that wider community, especially when you're as big and as impactful as Apple is. And so we took it outside and then we offered inside so that they would know we were still serving them. We weren't selling them. We were helping, we were serving, we were educating. And hopefully out of that entire experience, their lives were being enriched.
So Angela, you know, when you look at the success you've had in your career, and you know, you said, I mean, obviously I have to believe you've been ambitious to have an impact, but you say, you know, you haven't thought much about power and much about titles. But it seems to me there's two ways to succeed, right? There's a way of succeeding that comes from the heart and where you're lifting people up and you're truly in that servant leadership mode. But there's a reason my friend Bob Sutton at Stanford wrote a book called The No Asshole Rule, right? Because there's another way of succeeding, which is called hoarding power and managing up and kissing ass and stepping on the necks of colleagues and doing whatever it takes to get ahead. So if somebody says, listen, I want to build the kind of success that comes from being real and human. You talked about a couple things, Angela, so far that are super important. You know, you talked about, like, at whatever your level, communicating, being open, putting yourself out there, letting people see you, be human. You talked about being vulnerable. I don't know if you want to add a little bit to that. And you talked about looking for every opportunity to kind of upgrade the employee experience and to kind of close some of that hierarchical distance. If you were going to give an aspiring leader, let's say we have somebody listening to us today who's in a business school, who's like, you know, hearing this and saying, you know, I want to be the kind of leader that Angela's been through her career. What are the habits they need to develop? What other tips or tools, techniques do you give them? What do they need to be doing every day when they're going to find themselves in environments that often reward the other kind of behaviors? Where does that courage come from? Where's the moral integrity? How do you keep that alive in an institution where often the way you win is going to be quite the reverse of that?
Yeah, but I think it's also, that becomes an individual sport, where I actually think that if you can unite a team behind you, you have a much higher probability of success. So, you know, my dad used to always say, ask questions, don't make assumptions. And if you ask a question, listen, don't answer it yourself, like truly listen. And then I would say, be vulnerable. And can I tell you, in 2008, when the world was collapsing and Burberry went from being up 20 to down 40, and we're in the middle of investing in a multi-million dollar new headquarters, you know, you're on the cusp of Armageddon, what do you do? And I pulled 150 executives together and I said, I've never done this before. We need to cut 50 million pounds out of the business by December. And my instincts are, let's not cut anything consumer facing. My instincts are, we're a big old company. We probably, you know, we need to batten down the hatches over here, but we probably have a lot of heavyweight other places that we could. So I need your help. Can we take the next 48 hours? And can you guys all come back together with the list of how and when you think we should do this? And I'm open to any suggestions. I need your help. You know your worlds, you know your teams, you know what's more important than I do. Again, my instincts say, let's not cut anything consumer facing because this will pass, and let's use this as an opportunity to jettison past the competition. And they came back and in 48 hours came up with a game plan. And within 2 months, Gary, not four, they cut 50 million pounds out of that business. And to this day, I can't give you the details on how they did that. But they owned it and they wanted to win. And they were united behind, you know, the mission. And the mission is sometimes hard. But I think when you're vulnerable, and I, you know, I am now chairing Save the Children. I have never been a chair. I have never been in the NGO sector. I don't know what I don't know. But I do know there's some great commercial things that maybe we could bring into the sector to get them to look at things a little different ways. I am so proud because we just went through the most inclusive three-year strategy session. Every single person in the organization was involved bottoms up, helping build their strategy for the first time. And so it doesn't matter what industry you're in. I've done this in fashion, I've done it in tech and retail, and now I'm doing it in NGO. What's the common denominator? People. And they have a heart, and they just want to be loved, and they want to belong, and they want somebody to acknowledge them. And, you know, and that's where I think we miss it. You know, I've always said we're in the human business. And guess what? These humans happen to be focused on fashion, and these humans happen to be focused on tech, you know, but you're in above and beyond. We're in the people business.
Angela, can I ask you maybe to say a little bit more about the strategy process you've just helped, you know, hatch and incubate and evolve at Save the Children? Because you're playing the role of chair, right? Chairman of the board. So you're not the CEO, you're not at the helm, right? So it's a slightly different role from the previous one you played. So I'd love to understand your role and how you helped, get your colleagues to first of all, understand that this is the right thing to do and that it could be done. And then maybe also tell us a little bit more about the actual mechanics, like how did this unfold over time and what was the level of involvement that people had and what were the, what was the output of it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and again, we're in the midst of it now, but you're absolutely right. I am the chair. And the only remit the board asked was for the first 6 months, would I lean in much more frequently and partner with the leadership team so that they could have a transformative strategy over the course of the 6 months. So I have been leaning in a bit more, mostly with the CEO and her team, because there's an amazing group of experts that know the sector and do a mag. They're one of the largest in the sector, but they also understand that the dynamics have changed, right? So COVID, climate, conflict have caused the world to go back 10 years in 1 year, 10 years. So you have choices. We're tied to the UN sustainable goals and the 2030 goals. And everyone in the world wants to achieve those goals. So you've gone backwards 10 years. So what we said early on was, and this is where I thought my leadership was important. So I said very early on a video to the entire 25,000 boots on the ground. And I said, we don't want to change the goalpost. So in order to make up for that 10 years, we're going to have to work three times faster. We're going to have to be three times more efficient. We're going to need three times more partners. We're going to need to embed our programs locally because that's more efficient, et cetera, and more sustainable. So I went through this list of things. And if we do those, I think in 3 years, we could make up those 10 years. But we need all of your help. You're there, you know what's possible and what's not possible. And also we're doing 57 things in 120 countries. What things maybe shouldn't we do so we can reallocate and make sure that we triple our impact for children? And that's all we cared about was tripling our impact. And we talked very early on about bringing in a chief impact officer. So that we could, if we're serious about doing it, we're going to have to really measure ourselves, et cetera. So I started out high level sharing the narrative and sharing it then throughout the organization. Now there's an amazing team of people, and it was three times the technology, really levering technology, especially fintech, et cetera, to get vouchers and payments out. So, you know, I kind of worked up front just high level vision, and you'll see what people adapt to or don't adapt to. But you can't move the goalpost. So there are assumptions that you make. And as the chair, I can't get involved in every detail, but I can still inspire them, you know, no different than JFK and a man on the moon. I can still, you know, and guess what? You got to bring them back safely and you got to do it by this time. And so I was trying to just put out that type of a, and then the team use technology and went out to all of the members and had monthly sessions, get engaging everyone on their feedback. And they've come back with an incredibly unique strategy. It won't get announced until the end of October because it's for 22 to 24. And it's an incredibly new narrative, incredible. And that came from the teams. It was not a part of my original high level, but it's absolutely brilliant.
Yeah, I can't wait to read it. And I'm sure that you won't have to spend even a minute selling the strategy to the entire organization, because guess what? The organization actually helped shape it, right? So, because that's always the problem. Like, you know, people think, oh, if we can just create our own strategy top down in a cloistered environment, maybe we'll invite some consultants to help us out. We can get it done in a few months. But then you got to tell everybody else what the strategy is, convince them. And what you've done is instead a process that is shared, participative, right? And very much like the stories you had at Apple. And so like the time to impact that you'll generate is much faster, you know, even though this was more deliberative. And I think a lot of leaders still don't quite understand that. They just look at sort of time to decision as opposed to time to impact. That I'm so glad that you took this other approach.
Well, and the thing is, they all own it now. Yeah. They all know about it. You don't do it and then you have to teach it to them. They're all a part of it. And what's interesting is some of the offices, they're already starting to do things that we put in the strategy for next year. I mean, it's unbelievable because they feel it's the right thing to do. And why wait? You know, they can start partnering. They can start doing some of this stuff now. So
Yeah, I think it's a wonderful example because, you know, I've always believed that the conversation about destiny, where are we going as an organization, has to be like this firm-wide, all-the-time conversation. And still the number, I mean, what you're describing here, Angela, let's be clear. This like almost never happens. This is amazingly rare that people feel like I get a voice in shaping the destiny of this organization. And in fact, I can tell you some very big CEOs, big leaders who will say, no, it's the sole responsibility of the executive team to shape the future and set the direction, and then we'll kind of roll that out. So that's a radical thing to do. But the only way you turn on not only the commitment, but all the imagination of all those people. I like to end, if I can, with two themes that we've talked about, where I think you have insights that are really useful, Angela. You know, what is around maybe even the definition of a leader or leadership? I have this sense that word leader or leadership has become so devalued. You know, I hear people talk about, quotes, the leadership team. And I can tell you in many organizations that those people are only leaders because like they've self-appointed, right? If their team could vote them off the island, they probably would. They're they're a team by only the loosest definition. They're often at each other's throats. They're not very well aligned. And so, you know, historically, the word leader has come to mean somebody with particular positional power. So when you're looking at somebody at any level, Angela, and you're trying to assess, is that person really a leader? I know you're not going to look at rank or title, but what would you look at over time or in a first meeting, whatever? What do you exemplify as a leader in this new kind of authority-phobic kind of post-hierarchical world?
Yeah, you know, a leader to me... A leader to me doesn't talk about themselves. A leader to me talks about everything that they've been able to inspire the group to do, if you will. And they talk more about the bigger outcome and the bigger, and one example comes to mind, right? You've got three young founders at Airbnb that have all worked together for 12 years and they're on the brink of going public and COVID hits. And they went from being up dramatically to down 95 and now had to lay off a third of the workforce that they've literally just hired. Some of the brightest, most brilliant people in the world. And they've created a culture of belonging and all that Brian, the CEO, all that Brian said was, I got to help these 1,900 people. I have to help them. What can I do? He asked all of them for their CV. He created a website. He put all the CVs and their photos on the website. He then wrote a letter to editors everywhere and put it all out on social media. That here are 1,900 of the greatest, most talented people you will ever meet. And unfortunately, he has to let them go, but he will give them a reference. He will connect them with someone else to give them a reference, but he just put it out there. Then he extended their healthcare benefits for an extra 6 or 12 months. He extended their severance. I mean, he cared. It was never once about him. It was never, he leaned in for 6 months till 80% of those people were reemployed. That's a leader. That's a leader.
So it starts with we and not I. Yeah. I think that's a very early clue in talking to anybody about what they've accomplished. Is it a story about us or is it a story about me? And that's probably a pretty good signal.
Yeah, you know, growing up, my dad used to always say that he will know I'm one of six kids, and he would always say, I'll know I've done a really great job. If when you look at a photo, you look at yourself last.
You know, that's maybe a particular challenge in the Instagram world, but a good one to have. You know, Angela, so here's the last.
Keep it in perspective, right?
Yeah,
Everyone else is more important, and everyone plays a role. And life is too big. Life is communities, companies, everything's too big. I used to say at Burberry, we're too big to be an individual sport. We need to work like a brilliant team. We need to hand off, pass off, stay connected, you know, use our instincts to know when someone needed help or you had to pick up something. You know, it wasn't about blame. It was about support. And when you build that culture of just trust and love and unity, then again, the data shows the outperformance of the company. And some people call it purpose and culture. And of course, those are all the buzzwords. But you're just everybody wants to belong, Gary. Everybody in society, we weren't born to be individuals. We couldn't survive as an individual. So why do companies think they can survive with individuals in these? It's the individual's job to connect and unite and empower. And then you've unleashed this, you know, this, and it's like one big giant mind that's so, and like I said, at Burberry, I was the enabler and the connector. And then honestly, half the time I had to get out of the way and just let it go. You know, their dreams became bigger than my dream. But I don't think they can't let go, because it's not about you. You are a servant to that brand, to that company, to those people in that community. And I think you could use that analogy in politics, in education, and I would argue the higher up on that value chain you are, then the greater the responsibility.
You know, Angela, it's interesting that you've made this, you know, you've moved from the corporate world now into NGO. You know, 100 years ago or more, Mary Parker Follett, probably the first great management guru, certainly in America, made the journey the other way from being a community organizer in Boston and then got asked to start to advise companies. And what she said over and over again is a leader is somebody who seeks power with, not power over. And I think, you know, you've given us a wonderful kind of story of how that has motivated you and where it's led you. The last thing I'd like to ask you about, you said it very quickly, but you said people want to be loved. And one of the things that has always been kind of mystifying to me is why we can't talk about love inside the walls of a company. And why we so seldom talk about beauty, and why we so seldom talk about, you know, courage, and all of these things that mean so much to us as individuals. And somehow that business environment has become so banal or so profane, I don't know what word to use, that you can hardly even talk about the things that matter most to us as human beings without feeling awkward. Like, you know, this is like not quite so. How did we end up there? How do we reclaim that humanity and where we can think about the entire human being at work rather than, you know, a portfolio of skills or a task to get done? Because that was a rather startling thing you said. I mean, at least in a work environment.
Yeah, and it's funny because I used to be the same, but I guess I learned. I learned at each of my stops. I learned specifically at Burberry. And I had a team and we did love each other and we respected each other and trusted each other. So we actually started to talk openly about it. And one time when Christopher and I were doing one of these big, you know, all hands on meetings, we actually talked about it and said how much we loved and appreciated and respected everything they were doing. And then it was so fascinating because the following season, the entire design collection came up with what they called the Love Collection. And it was, I mean, there were hearts on everything. No, but it united the company even more. I mean, throughout the 30 countries, everyone would see that. And they knew exactly the genesis of it. They remember the conversation. And funny, those are the pieces downstairs I can't get rid of. Those are the ones still sitting in the closet but everyone embraced it. There was not a person in the company who did not want to feel loved. By anyone, but the fact that we did, and we had put all types of communication tools in place, and we had them all talking to each other, and they felt incredibly connected. And you know, it's funny. I was at Apple. We were opening a big store in Brooklyn, and the store didn't open for a couple of hours. And I was in early touring and going through some of the stuff. And there were about five, and I can call them kids because they were about the age of my kids. And these five young guys were standing there. I think maybe there was one girl. And they just looked at me and they said, thank you. And they were like, thank you, thank you. And I kind of looked at them and they said, we're not supposed to be to work for another hour, but we just love coming. We love coming here. We love being here. We don't even want to go home. This is our family, you know? And then they each shared stories. And that environment in that store, they were safe, they were loved, they were happy. They were giving everything they had. And maybe they didn't get all that at home, right? We don't know everyone's personal environment. We don't know. But those kids came an hour early because they wanted to. It wasn't work to them. This was their life where they could do their greatest work and they were so happy and fulfilled by it. And I don't understand why that's so hard to create. I don't, and to your point, I don't understand why people don't talk more about it. But I think it goes back to the very beginning. You know, sorry to quote my father, but he was my guru my whole life. And he always used to tell us when we were young, I can teach you anything, but I can't teach you to care. So make sure wherever you put yourself, you care deeply. He used to say, what breaks your heart? Because then he knew we would put our heart into it. And so I think that if people are in positions and it's about power and it's not about heart and love, then I don't know how you can change them. I would ask them what breaks their heart. And because I think until they truly feel it, you know, you can't teach someone to care. You can, you know, they can go through the motions, but unfortunately that'll do more damage because that next generation sees right through it.
Yeah, they have pretty good meters on that. You know, one of my favorite New Yorker cartoons, it shows two executives, men, walking along some street, and one is saying to the other cynically, empathy, yeah, I can see how that might work. But clearly it's clearly not something you can fake. And it comes from a very deep spot in you, Angela, that's clear. And I think that question, what breaks your heart? And I can tell you for Michele and I, what breaks our heart is seeing millions and millions of people at work who are in jobs where they don't have the dignity and the opportunity and the sense of equity that is, you know, part of every human being's birthright. And, you know, you've changed that in the organizations where you've worked, and I'm sure you'll continue to change it. So, Andrew, such an immense pleasure. Thank you for sharing this time and sharing your wisdom. Thank you.
Thank you, Michele. Thank you, Gary, very much.